beautiful drive up here today. I'm Pastor Warren Agable, retired ELCA pastor. I live in Alloway in Green Bay. From 89 to 99, I served at Grace Lutheran Church downtown. And most recently, I served in Pennsylvania for 18 and a half years in the Philadelphia area, and also in the Pennsylvania coal country. I retired 5 years ago. I can tell that you have a woman pastor here. That pastor's office has a much different look these days. It's really beautiful there. And this is really lovely too. A Google display for the fall. On the bulletin or cover, it says in today's gospel reading, Jesus tells a vineyard parable that serves as an image of Israel, the prophet's mission, and Christ's death. For Christians, the vineyard also speaks of God's love poured out in the blood of Christ, given to us for the forgiveness of sin. Grafted onto Christ, the vine of baptism, we are nourished with wine and bread, so that we may share Christ's suffering and know the power of his resurrection. A wonderful paragraph. Summary really of our of not only our gospel reading but the other readings also today. We also have announcements at this time. Anybody like to make an announcement for the good of the order? I see that you have the education hour following the service today, and it looks like you're having your fall congregational meeting next Sunday again following the worship service. It's always a time to fall where things start coming back again, and I know in the church that I attend in Green Bay, the Ascension Lutheran, we started our education hour. We're looking at the book of Micah in the Old Testament for adult study. So please rise as you are able for our brief order of confession and forgiveness. Blessed be God, the one who forms us, Jesus who bears the cross, the Spirit who makes our joy complete.
Amen.
Let us bow before God in humility, confessing our sin. Let us now in silence reflect and examine ourselves, and so reflect. Steadfast and faithful God, you have revealed the ways of justice, yet we fail to follow you. We are overwhelmed by the world's violence and suffering. We are afraid to risk what we have for the sake of others. For the harm we have caused, known and unknown, forgive us. For the unjust demands we place on others, in our creation, forgive us. For the ways we turn away from you and our neighbor, forgive us. Lead us back to you and set us on the right path. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen.
Beloved in Christ, God's justice stretches beyond all understanding. God's compassion is beyond compare. In Jesus, God is always making a new way for us. In Christ, you are ready and always forgiven.
Amen.
Our gathering hymn is When I Survey the Wondrous Cross, hymn 803.
Thank you. from Isaiah chapter 5, verses 1 to 7. Let me sing for my beloved my love song concerning his vineyard. My beloved had a vineyard on a very fertile hill. He dug it and cleared it of stones and planted it with choice vines. He built a watchtower in the midst of it and hewed out a wine vat in it. He expected it to yield grapes, but it yielded wild grapes. And now, inhabitants of Jerusalem and people of Judah, judge between me and my vineyard. What more was there to do for my vineyard that I have not done in it? When I expected it to yield grapes, why did it yield wild grapes? And now I will tell you what I will do to my vineyard. I will remove its hedge, and it shall be devoured. I will break down its wall, and it shall be trampled down. I will make it a waste. It shall not be pruned or hoed, and it shall be overgrown with briars and thorns. I will also command the clouds that they rain no rain upon it. For the vineyard of the Lord of hosts is the house of Israel, and the people of Judah are his pleasant planting. He expected justice, but saw bloodshed. Righteousness, but heard a cry. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
We will do a psalm reading, and you will read the bold print. Restore us, O God of hosts. Let your light, let your face shine upon us, and we shall be saved.
You have brought the fire of Egypt. You cast out the nations and planted it.
You cleared the ground for it. It took root and filled the land.
The mountains are covered by its shadow, and the towering cedar trees by its boughs.
You stretched out its tendrils to the sea and its branches to the river.
I have been broken down its walls, so that all the grass have lost its grace.
The wild boar of the forest have ravished it, and the beasts of the field have grazed upon it.
Turn now, O God of hosts, look down from heaven.
Behold and tend this vine, preserve what your right hand has planted. The second reading is from Philippians chapter 3. Paul writes, if anyone else has reason to be confident in the flesh, I have more. Circumcised on the eighth day, a member of the people of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew born of Hebrews, as to the law, a Pharisee, as to zeal, a persecutor of the church, as to righteousness under the law, blameless. Yet whatever gains I had, these I have come to regard as loss because of Christ. More than that, I regard everything as loss because of the surpassing value of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord. For his sake I have suffered the loss of all things, and I regard them as rubbish. In order that I may gain Christ and be found in him, not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law, but one that comes through faith in Christ, and the righteousness from God based on faith. I want to know Christ and the power of his resurrection and the sharing of his sufferings by becoming like him in his death, if somehow I may attain the resurrection from the dead. Not that I have already attained this or have already reached the goal, but I press on to make it my own, because Christ Jesus has made me his own. Beloved, I do not consider that I have made it on my own, but this one thing I do, forgetting what lies behind and straining forward to what lies ahead, I press on toward the goal for the prize of the heavenly call of God in Christ Jesus. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
a wine press in it and built a watchtower. Then he leased it to tenants and went to another country. When the harvest time had come, he sent his slaves to the tenants to collect his produce. But the tenants seized his slaves and beat one, killed another, and stoned another. Again, he sent other slaves, more than the first, and they treated them in the same way. Finally, he sent his son to them, saying, "Oh, they will respect my son." But when the tenants saw the son, they said to themselves, "This is the heir. Come, let us kill him and get his inheritance." So they seized him, threw him out of the vineyard, and killed him. Now when the owner of the vineyard comes, what will he do to those tenants? They said to him, "He will put those wretches to a miserable death and lease the vineyard to other tenants who will give him the produce at the harvest time." Jesus said to them, "Have you never read in the scriptures, 'The stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone? This was the Lord's doing, and it is amazing in our eyes.' Therefore I tell you, the kingdom of God will be taken away from you and given to a people that produces the fruits of the kingdom. The one who falls on this stone will be broken to pieces, and it will crush anyone on whom it falls." When the chief priests and Pharisees heard this parable, they realized that he was speaking about them. They wanted to arrest him, but they feared the crowds because they regarded him as a prophet. The Gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Brothers, sisters in Christ, grace be on you and peace from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Sometimes conflicts between people get very hot, and then hotter still, and then they accelerate until the conflict explodes. You think of the fires out west 2 years ago and this past summer. The rust was flickering, and then it got a bigger flame, and suddenly, really, the whole forest exploded in a fire. A large pine tree was all aflame with this intense inferno. Well, things also what took place in Maui and Hawaii, that raging inferno. Such can be a conflict with people. Have you ever had a conflict with someone where the conflict just grew and grew and grew and then finally exploded? Maybe your conflict was with your husband or your wife. The fires of feelings grew worse and intense. Believe it or not, my wife and I have had arguments where it has been that way. It started with something really small. Sometimes we couldn't even remember what it was that started the argument. But then, It grew and it exploded between us. The argument starts small and the blaze of feelings gets more energy and finally explodes into a shouting match. That's the way it is with us human beings. I don't like it. I'm not proud of it, but it sometimes happens. Maybe you had a conflict with your son or daughter, or your in-laws, or a conflict with a person at work. And as the months and the years have gone by, that conflict has grown into a major inferno, a blaze. It started out like a little fire, but that fire has spread to epic proportions between you and that other person at work. Maybe the conflict was between you and your neighbor, or maybe with another person at school. We don't like it when the fires of conflict are burning. We become upset. We become distracted. That person stays in our minds sometimes way too long for these hurt feelings we have against that person. I wish that we weren't that way, but to be honest, that happens oftentimes. Well, this conflict in our text for today, this small fire between Jesus and the Pharisees, we even have a Pharisee mentioned in our second lesson. Of course, Paul was a Pharisee. met. It was right after the call of Matthew. Now, Matthew, of course, is a tax collector by profession. Matthew, the writer of this gospel. Matthew had dinner with the so-called scum of society, that is, according to the Pharisees, the tax collectors and other sinners. Right at the very beginning of Jesus' ministry, Jesus was hanging out with the wrong kind of people, and it offended the Pharisees. He violated the Sabbath regulations that the Pharisees were imposing on the people. Jesus healed a man on the Sabbath, no less. And early on in Mark, as it says, in Mark 3:6, the New Testament says that the Pharisees held counsel with another religious party, and political party for that matter, the Herodians, on how to destroy him. In other words, from the get-go, the Pharisees were out to kill him. From the get-go, the Pharisees were secretly angry with Jesus. They wanted to do him in. 3 years passed, and now we come to our text for today, which is for the end of Matthew's gospel, the first gospel. And that conflict between Pharisees and Jesus is growing hotter and hotter by the week, by the month, by the year, so that now we're in the last week of Jesus' public ministry, and it's at the exploding point. That's where we kind of start today's text, in Matthew chapters 21 through 24. We have this conflict between Jesus and the Pharisees. When Jesus is in Jerusalem, the holy city, and it reaches epic proportions, you will find 13 consecutive incidents of a growing conflict in the Gospel of Matthew for this struggle between Jesus and the Pharisees. It's like a person in the middle of a forest fire, and the bushes and the trees explode in flame. So now in Matthew 21 through 24, those chapters, all sorts of fires are exploding. For example, Jesus begins by casting out the money changers from the temple and saying that to the temple leaders that God's temple has become a den of robbers. Jesus even made a whip of cords and drove them all out, overturning the tables of the money changers. This is the angriest we ever see Jesus in the Gospel of Matthew. Then he gives a message that has many levels of meaning. He curses a fig tree that had produced no fruit, and the tree withers on the spot. This is, of course, an example of how the Pharisees were. They looked good and green like a flush tree, but there was no fruit on that fine-looking tree. He told the Pharisees that the tax collectors and the prostitutes would get into heaven before they would. He said that the Pharisees were a bunch of hypocrites who were like a brood of vipers who were trying to escape in a fire in the desert. One of the signs that fire was raging was the snakes were fleeing out of the desert, slithering out of the desert. The Pharisees were the symbolic children of those who killed the prophets in the Old Testament. And they killed John the Baptist, his cousin. And of course, they were on their way to killing him. So he was really upfront with the truth. It's with this mood we approach the parable for today. It's a very powerful parable. It tells us that the Pharisees were the ones who killed the prophets in the Old Testament and would kill the Son of God in the near future, and would even kill the apostles of the church also in the near future. 11 of the 12 original apostles died martyrs. Yes. Even Matthew himself would be one of them. there is this man who was the owner of a vineyard. The owner took a trip, put his vineyard under the care and supervision of some renters. These renters were expected to make a payment to the owner for the rental of the vineyard. Now the owner was gone for a while. The owner sent a messenger to collect the payment due, and renters beat up the representative. The owner then sent a second representative to collect the payment due, and the renters not only beat up this man, but they killed the envoy. Well, now the owner sent many envoys to collect the payment due, and the renters beat them up as well and killed them. Wow, this owner was persistent. The owner finally sent his only son to collect the money due. And the renters thought to themselves, the owner thought to himself, they will surely respect my own son. But they even killed him. They killed the owner's son. Can you imagine that? They even had said to themselves, let's kill the son and we'll have the inheritance. What a perverted logic. Then Jesus continued the story. And what will the owner do? Well, he will come back and kill the renters. Yes, he will. The owner will come and kill those evil renters and find new renters who will pay him the rent that is due. I tell you the truth. The kingdom of God will be taken away from you. The original hearers are the Pharisees. And then we have, of course, a longer term meaning here. It will be given to people who will pay the rent and produce the fruit of righteousness. Now, what's the fruit of righteousness? Of course, in Galatians, we have the seven fruits of righteousness. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, self-control. Sometimes our candelabra on the altar are indicative of those seven fruits of the Spirit. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, self-control. The Gospel of Matthew adds, when those Pharisaical leaders realized that he told this parable against them, they started their plan. They hatched their plan even more to have been killed. But they couldn't even run away because they feared the crowd and they went away. They waited until a better time. Of course, that better time later on was in the Garden of Gethsemane, when even one of his own disciples was set up to betray him. And they collaborated with the Roman officials. When the crowd wasn't around, then the Pharisees would arrest him. And later on, in these trumped up trials, would sentence him to death. And people like Herod, people like Pilate, would also be in on the plot to have him killed, killed outside of Jerusalem. Really, a garbage dump. That was the Pharisees' goal, kill the son. They had already killed the messengers, the prophets. Now they were going to kill the son, the only son. What a confrontation we have here in this text. What a parable that we know was a culmination of what went on during New Testament times. So in this parable, we know that the renters are the Pharisees, first of all. But they aren't only them. The people throughout history in the Old Testament that silenced the voice of God, he was saying to them, I own the vineyard, it is mine. You are to pay the rent. The rent is the fruit of the Spirit. But you have not only not done what was expected of you, but you have killed my very messengers. Also, many of the prophets, probably the greatest period in the history of the Old Testament was the 8th century. The period of the 8th century was the really flourishing of the prophets in both the Northern Kingdom and the Southern Kingdom. The 8th He was in the southern kingdom of Judea at the very time, and in the north was the prophet Micah in the area of Samaria, where we would know in the New Testament the parable of the Good Samaritan, those people that intermarried with the local Canaanites, and that other Jews didn't see them as true blue Jews. They had lots of prejudice against these people. So even in that very period of the 8th century, Micah in the north, Isaiah in the south. Now, Isaiah would appear to have lived his life to old age, but the mindfulness one that was run in by the authorities. So, Jesus wanted the Pharisees to know that God knew that they were the ones that had killed the prophets. Jesus wanted the Pharisees to know that he knew that they were the ones that were going to plot to kill him, they and others. So how does this parable apply to us today, some 21 centuries later? Well, we too can oftentimes silence the messengers of God to us, especially when they tell us unpleasant things about our lives. When they say, like they said to the Pharisees, you're hypocrites. When they say to us, we're phonies. When we aren't doing the thing that is right and good out in society, we have people that come to us and are honest with us about things that are imperfect in our lives. Now, what can those messengers be? Who can they be? What do they sometimes say to us? Sometimes there are people very close to us. People that are right in our family can be messengers of God to us. And then sometimes my wife is a messenger from God to me, pointing out things to me. You know, I grumble and groan at the things that she points out. I act sort of like a spoiled child. And then after a while, I realize that the thing that she's pointed out is probably something I ought to take notice of, especially in the relationship we have with each other in our marriage of 48 years. I also note that sometimes when I try to chide my children, they're not very young anymore, 41, 43. But you still have a chance to share with your children whatever age they may be, things that you see paths they ought not be going on, or consequences that are going to come in their life if they take a wrong turn. The prophets of God are not usually the paid preacher or the TV evangelist. No, they could be somebody really close to us. Sometimes it's a neighbor. Sometimes it's a friend. And deep down, we often want to hear that, and we try to silence it. We try to silence the messenger. Well, in our nation, we certainly know that there are prophets. There are prophets that speak about of what the fruits of the Spirit are there being suppressed. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, self-control, how they're being suppressed oftentimes in our society. That's also a theme of this parable. Have we silenced people that want to bring us back to the straight and narrow way? Well, the fundamental part for the Pharisees is that they were not producing the fruit of righteousness. They were not living lives of goodness, kindness, gentleness, compassion for those in need. God gave us our life. God has given us the vineyard to live in. The vineyard is God's. He is the true owner. He owns all the world. Owns our very life. This is a period of time often in the church here where we speak about stewardship. What a great message this is today about stewardship in our own life and in the life of our community, the life of our nation, the life in our church. What is rent for us? What is rent? Well, certainly they are the fruits of righteousness. The Pharisees were not willing to pay the rent that God wanted and demanded from them for living in God's vineyard. Well, I think God wants us to pay rent as well. We know at the end of the month when we have Reformation Sunday about the great hallmark of the Reformation, we are saved by grace through faith. It's like grasping the hand that has already grasped your hand. This rent is not how we are saved, but it is a result of being saved, of living in God's kingdom, of having that wonderful relationship with the Savior. Moral lives of righteousness is certainly a part of that rent. It's not works righteousness, kind of life we do about works in order to be saved. No, not at all. God wants us to have the fruits of the Spirit in order to further the kingdom in our own life and, of course, in the world. Now, in this passage, there's another ending here that is hard to stomach, really. There's not only the threat of God punishing the renters who refuse to pay the rent, there's the second threat in the parable in which Jesus teaches that God will find other people who will pay the rent and live moral lives of righteousness. God can and will find people who will give God his due, who will live lives of goodness, kindness, and compassion. Sometimes, back then, those people were outside the synagogue, like he mentions the tax collectors and the sinners. But even in our own day and age, there are people that God will use outside of our own walls of the church, of the worship center, who also will be full of compassion and love. God will find those people, regardless oftentimes of their label that they wear, and use them also to further the kingdom. So he's saying, look also at this in your day and age, in your time on earth, in your era. The voice of God is going out always across the earth. The voice of God is going out always in one's neighborhood. And listen to the voice or voices of my messengers that I send to your life. And also listen to the voices that are out there that are speaking my word. God owns the vineyard of the world we live in. It is God's. God expects rent, payment. What is the payment that God, the owner of the world, wants from us? Well, fruits of righteousness. A life of love, a life of compassion for God and our neighbors. Amen. And now our hymn of the day is the Church of Christ in Every Age, hymn 729. Thank you.
trusting in the transformative power of God's loving Spirit, let us pray for the church, the world, and all in need. God of all grace, you are the source of life and joy. Strengthen the resolve of your church throughout the world, that together we press on toward the goal of your heavenly call in Jesus Christ. God of grace, God of all creation, you plant and nourish the earth as your own precious vineyard. Bless fields and orchards in the hands of those who labor in them, that your people are fed with an abundant harvest of good fruit. God of grace, God of all the earth, you desire peace and justice between nations and peoples. Guide leaders of nations, states, provinces, and cities, that they faithfully govern your people with wisdom, integrity, and compassion. God of grace, God of all compassion, in Christ you lovingly poured yourself out like wine for your people. Have mercy on all who mourn, who struggle with their mental health, who cry out for justice, who hunger, and all in any need of prayer, especially Joan, Beverly, Scott, Pat, Chuck, Kurt, Geraldine, Randy, and all those we name aloud now or silently in our hearts. God of grace, God of all steadfastness, you set Christ as the cornerstone and foundation of the church. Build up this congregation as living stones, that it stands in the community as a witness to your enduring faithfulness and love. God of grace, God of all hope, the saints who came before us lived and died with their hearts fixed on you. We give you thanks for their faithful witness, and we wait with hope for the great day when we join their voices in praise. God of grace,
gracious God, into your hands we commend all for whom we pray. Trust in your unending love and amazing grace. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior.
Amen.
May the peace of Christ be with you always.
And also with you.
We share the peace.
Thank you.
These last are all three hymns, hymn 674.
Break
the gift of your spirit in our gathering within this day. all are welcome. You may be seated.
Thank you. for we have feasted on your word. Christ Jesus, the joy and the light of our hearts. Strengthen by this food, send us to gather the world to your banquet, where none are left out and all are satisfied. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Receive the benediction. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord's face shine upon you with grace and mercy. The Lord look upon you with favor and grant you peace.
Amen.
Our sending hymn is My Lord of Life, hymn 8.